At the start of the pandemic, I reported for Dateline on the devastating impact COVID-19 was having on the homeless population here where I live in Los Angeles.
Over the past year, the impact of COVID has only gotten worse for everyone. We've lost 22 million jobs, and the unemployment rate here peaked at 21%.
In Los Angeles alone, 20,000 people have died from COVID-19, with over 500,000 deaths nationwide. On top of that, it's been a year marred by violence, division, and lies. With little faith left in the institutions designed to protect them, many Americans are seeking answers from the spiritual world.
This year has really brought me closer to God.
I think people are afraid, and so some people choose to find a solution in religion as a way to alleviate those fears and anxieties.
I want to find out what's behind this religious recovery and whether solace can be found in the supernatural.
A lot of clients are seeing things or hearing things that are not in the normal.
If anybody's up here, come show yourself.
There was a presence in this house, in this room, that I'd never felt before.
It's 8 a.m. in Los Angeles. For many people, this lineup has replaced the weekly trip to the grocery store.
Times are hard. Things have been going crazy lately with the whole COVID thing. It's risen up like pretty badly.
Before the pandemic, LA Food Bank fed 300,000 people monthly. CEO Michael Flood said that number has increased to 900,000.
You know, what the pandemic has done, it's just put a lot of people out of work. So that's just put this pressure on the budgets for families and individuals to meet all their basic needs. So we're seeing a lot of people come through these types of distributions who are new to need. They've never sought food assistance in their entire life.
People like 45-year-old single mom Araceli have had to rely on handouts from NGOs.
And how many people are in your house?
Two. I am a mom to an 8-year-old who's had a 25-year career in politics.
All right, thank you so much, okay? Bye, thank you, it's a great help.
Ever since COVID, it's been a year that I haven't worked. And so, I find myself using the LA Regional Food Bank to be able to put food on the table for me and my little family. So I got the food bank for food, and then my cell phone, and I'm deferring the utilities because it's not enough. I am like completely defeated, feeling helpless. For the first time in my life, with no money, no hope in sight. But when my friends and I got together and we started to pray for each other, you know, they had people who died of COVID, uncles, cousins, friends, all that. Then is when I started to regain that faith and strength again.
Araceli's faith is remarkable, but it's not unique. According to a recent report by Pew, almost one-third of Americans say their faith has grown stronger during the pandemic. They say it's African Americans leading this return to religion. So, with well over half of America's Black community living in America's southern states, I'm heading to Louisiana, a state with a long history of hardship and religious devotion.
Believer steps on the scene, there has to be an acknowledgement that we serve a living God and we believe in him because what? He loves us.
Then whenever someone... Streaming today to their 1,000 or so followers, the Destiny of Faith Church in Lafayette is on the front line of this religious revival.
When the pandemic came, we definitely saw a lot of people choose to go deeper. We saw more commitment increase by those who are already on the path.
There's so much going on that has put pressure on relationships, not just any relationship, but on godly relationships.
We were getting calls, we were getting messages, we were hearing from our families. And what we were hearing from them is that, hey, I not only miss this, but I need this. The fellowship, the community, coming together as one, encouraging each other through the Bible, through the Word of God. People were missing it.
Now, if you yourself need love, if you're watching online, you need love. You say, Alex, I am the one, I need love.
Whenever you choose to lean into those things that can encourage you, it bears fruit in your life. And sometimes the best type of fruit is just getting through a full day with joy, waking up and feeling peace instead of anxiety.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
But not all religious Americans are returning to traditional institutions.
I would go into a church and I'd see all these nameplates everywhere for the so-and-so donated this and so donated that. Big freaking deal. Who cares who donated what? That's what's wrong with it. That's the kind of mentality that has driven people away, because it's all about money now.
This is the one-of-a-kind Holy Nicolaitan Church in Georgia. It's run by Bishop Bryan. His church is an offshoot of Catholicism, minus the rigid rules. It's a New Age take on spirituality, and it's gaining popularity.
We went from, I'd say, maybe 50 to 100 people that were interested in our live stream to hundreds. And even now, I'd say that our viewership is in the thousands.
We simulcast it.
I think people are afraid, and so some people choose to find a solution in religion as a way to alleviate those fears and anxieties that the world presents, because there is something otherworldly about it, and there's a lot of peace and confidence that comes from faith in a God that is taking care of you. You don't necessarily get that from a therapist.
Alleluia.
No hallelujahs.
Before I was a priest, I worked in clinical psychology. You know, I mean, my degree is actually in psychology, not in religion.
Besides alleviating anxieties, as a priest and a psychologist, he's actually much better known for a controversial ritual that he performs.
There is a subset of behavior that seems to be spiritually motivated behavior that does not seem to respond to medication, does not respond to traditional psychotherapy, and things that normally would work for conditions that are well known and well established don't work for this subset of people.
Bryan performs exorcisms, a spiritual and religious practice that involves evicting demons from a person who's said to be possessed.
June was a big month. We had one, two, three.
During COVID, he says demand for exorcisms has skyrocketed. He now has a backlog of 500 cases.
18 cases.
Mm. And what are these people saying in their emails?
Let's pick one at random. I have a daughter who is having multiple personalities. She has been in several mental facilities in the past few weeks. She keeps saying abnormal things, and she says she sees dead people. She switches between being really sweet and really aggressive. We believe there is an evil spirit in her. We are not sure what else to do. Okay, the daughter's the one with the problem, but the family member's the one contacting us. That's a very good sign.
Okay.
Because typically speaking, they would be running from me and not want anything to do with me, and they would not be calling churches. The major concern, though, is, of course, mental health facilities, but that's not uncommon with a person. Demonically possessed people can sort of behave in a way that looks like DID. Mm-hmm. I mean, dissociative identity disorder or schizophrenia.
How much of a percentage of these people would you say are experiencing actual possession, and how many are just experiencing a mental illness?
Well, I mean, the ratios that are pretty much the same. It's usually between 70 to, 80-85% are more of a mental nature, which would mean that they would be better served looking at traditional therapy.
So a lot of people think of exorcism as just a fictional thing. How do you respond to non-believers?
For science to come say, oh, it's just all in your head,
It's ridiculous. Mm. Of course it's all in your head. But how is anything else not all in your head? Mm. It's just as real, and it affects them as much as anything external would. And you can interact externally, you can interact with them. Mm. And that's what we do.
Bryan says he's not surprised by the influx of people seeking his services, thanks to a tumultuous 2020.
I do think America is spiritually ill. I think most of the world is spiritually ill in various degrees. We have neglected the spiritual reality of our nature for so long, and we have been taught largely by the secularization of our society to marginalize it. It's not really necessary, or it's a nuisance.
Tonight, Bryan is visiting a client who says they are possessed. And Sister Mary Joan is coming along to administer the appropriate treatment.
I call this my go bag. This is okay. Actually my gear bag I used in law enforcement that I've repurposed for this.
There's a sword in there?
It's a dagger.
It's a dagger?
This is mostly used for ceremonial, but it is a blessed Templar dagger. And then plenty of holy water. And see, these are exorcised holy water. And then I've got blessed salt in here too. If we, God forbid, use all of our holy water, we can make more with exorcised salt.
In 2018, the Vatican released a statement saying the number of exorcisms carried out globally was rising. They stopped short of giving figures, but Bryan believes there's thousands of exorcisms performed in the U.S. each year.
Hi there. Come on in.
Bishop Bryan.
Hey.
You know Sister Mary Joan?
Nice to meet you, sweetheart.
To protect the client's identity, we're not using her real name. We'll call her Kathy. Before they initiate any exorcism rituals, Bryan wants to hear Kathy's story and assess her mental health.
So you had a dream about an angel that called himself an angel but didn't give a name. And that sort of was the catalyst to everything that...
That's where everything started.
That's where everything started.
Kathy claims a demon has been talking to her for years. But since the pandemic, it's become unbearable.
And you hear this audibly? Like the way you're hearing my voice now?
Yes, but now it talks to me 24/7. I mean, he's talking to me right now.
You're hearing voices right now?
No, just the one voice.
Just the one voice.
Just the one
it's
voice.
Always the same voice?
Yes.
Do you feel like you're being watched all the time?
Yes.
Okay. Have you ever levitated or have you ever seen her levitate?
No.
Any spontaneous fires? Any changes to your hair color that were not intended? Any foul odors, like the smell of sulfur, excrement, rotting flesh? How about physical attacks like punching, biting, hair pulling, or sexual assaults that are not being done by something you can see?
I don't know how to put this, but he has told me that he's already had relations with me.
Okay.
Bryan doesn't think Kathy is possessed, so rather than full exorcism, Bryan's decided to give some pastoral care.
Peace be unto this home.
And to all who dwell herein.
She didn't respond to anything in a way that a person who's oppressed or possessed would.
Amen.
Blessed is our God, always now and ever, even unto ages of ages. Amen. There was absolutely no need for exorcism, and it would have been inappropriate for me to even suggest it, because honestly, there was nothing demonic in her case that I could find.
The body of Christ.
I do think something within your physiology is leading you to have this disturbance. It could be so many factors, but I do think it is important for you to go for a psychotherapist and a Christian counselor, maybe not a psychiatrist. Let's try that, okay? Exorcism, not appropriate, not needed.
Good night, y'all.
Take care.
God bless you both.
Thank you. God bless
you. You'll be fine. Keep in touch, okay?
Yes.
Let sister know what's going on.
I want to understand how the events of 2020 are affecting America's psyche and whether Bishop Bryan's overflowing inbox is a symptom of declining mental well-being. I'm at the University of West Georgia with Dr. Christine Simmons-Moore.
Jackie, nice to meet you.
Elbow bump?
Yes.
Okay.
She's an expert in the psychology behind spirituality and paranormal experiences.
It's one of the few humanistic psychology departments in the world, honestly. So
she says the pandemic has significantly increased anxiety within the population.
Living with dying on a daily basis, actually. Living with loss, living with these big questions about existence and, you know, when is this going to end? This whole sense of a lack of control, I think, in people's lives is impacting them a lot. You know, it's, you know, no surprises really that you're going to see increases in anxiety and depression, and then all the effects on sleep.
Is there any therapeutic value to religion and spirituality?
Absolutely. It provides a sense of control for people. Also, I think in times of stress, there's evidence that people do become more what we call magical in their thinking. So they do tend to sort of see connections that may or may not be there. So paranormal, spiritual, religious, conspiracies, all of those things are magical ways of thinking and experiencing the world. And again, if people are having more experiences, they're trying to sort of make sense of them with different frameworks that are available to them.
But America already had a predisposition for magical thinking. A pre-COVID poll showed that 45% of Americans believe in a spirit world of ghosts and demons. I'm back in Louisiana to meet a couple who, at the height of the COVID-19 pandemic, reported what Dr. Christine would call magical thinking.
Good, nice to meet you. I'm Stephen, and this is Chad.
Chad and Stephen recently bought this house built in the 1840s. Shortly after moving in, things got weird.
People had been coming by to the house, knocking on the door, asking, hey, is this house haunted? Of course, we didn't feel anything.
Why,
we
just felt... They just knock on your door and they
ask just
you
random people.
Their first of several experiences was these antique clocks that hadn't worked in decades, suddenly coming back to life.
Definitely not a coincidence, but more than just two clocks going off in the same room. I've always been one for a good ghost story, but I've never experienced anything myself until that night. And truly, I knew something had just happened. There was a presence in this house, in this room, that I've never felt before.
It was undeniable. I feel like, especially in this St. Mary Parish area, you've heard more and more and more stories of the paranormal. It's more prevalent than it was, I'd say, a year ago.
With this pandemic, we've got a lot of deaths involved and a lot of uncertainty that I think kind of stirs up emotions personally that I believe can maybe be connected with the other side.
There was another time much later that we were sitting having dinner and this candle literally popped straight up and down. We hadn't hit the table. Even if we do hit the table, there's no way that it's gonna pop out straight up and down. So as all of this was coming in, we figured that we needed to get some professional help with this because we are not ghost experts, obviously. And we contacted Louisiana Spirits. It was pretty reputable.
I'm on my way to meet the team behind Louisiana Spirits as they prepare for an investigation at Chad and Steven's place tonight.
Marcy.
Hey, Jackie.
Hey.
Marcy is a school teacher by day, ghost hunter by night. She says demand for their paranormal investigations has never been higher.
We've definitely seen an uptick for my group personally, because people are home more, so they're more aware of their surroundings. And I feel like a lot of clients are seeing things or hearing things that are not in the normal.
Marcy and her team rely on a mix of store-bought and homemade equipment to investigate paranormal claims.
So what it does, it puts out an electromagnetic field around it, and anything that comes within that field, it's going to go off.
It's not purely scientific, but by collecting and collating data, Marcy attempts to be as credible as she can.
I say we pack up and head out.
All right, let's get our stuff and go.
All right.
Amazing.
So I think as a paranormal investigator, I need the data. So if we go into an investigation and we have a piece of equipment going off, we're having a personal experience at the same time, we capture a photo at the same time, or an EVP at the same time, we can put all of that together, kind of like a puzzle, and create the scenario, the situation that may have happened right then.
Okay, I definitely want a camera in the two rooms up on the third floor.
Okay. There's another plug right there.
Turn off the lights since it comes in.
Okay, 4, 3, 8, and 1 are on now. They look good.
First up, Marcy tries to capture what's called EVP, electronic voice phenomena.
It's okay to come out and talk to us.
It's the act of recording extremely low volume audio in the hope that a spirit responds to a question.
Are you a child? Whoever's here, do you like Chad and Steven? Do you like what they've done to the house?
So far, no response on audio. So next, they try a camera that can supposedly detect spirits.
So you can see it's mapping her. See how it moves on her as she moves? And that's what we're going to be looking for.
Do you think that any of this will convince actual scientists?
Well, we've had instances with this machine, the SLS. Well, they actually moved out of the way when we told them to move or raise their arms. You can see them actually raising whatever. We say left arm and it'll raise it. That's kind of hard to debunk when you're asking it questions and it's responding. So I would say yes. If anybody's up here, come show yourself. This machine will let us know y'all here. It won't hurt you.
After 5 hours, they found no clear evidence of spiritual activity.
Come out and show yourself.
All right, guys, so I think we did enough investigating tonight. I think we got enough evidence, so I think we should go ahead and tear everything down, wrap it up, and head back to Lafayette. What do you think?
Yep, that's good.
You good? All right, let's get to it.
But the next day, Marcy tells us to get over to their offices.
Okay, well, that's a piece of evidence right there.
They found something in their audio recordings.
It's definitely a female voice saying, who are you talking to?
Yeah.
That's a great catch, great catch. It's great because one, Chance asked a question, then the equipment went off, and then we have what sounds like to me a response. Who are you talking to? Awesome catch. Yeah, definitely isolate that one and keep it.
Homeowners Chad and Steven told Chance about Chloe, a former deceased servant who they believe could be haunting their home.
Is Chloe up here?
Yes, I heard it.
Oh,
you heard her say yes?
I did.
Want to hear it again? Is Chloe up here?
Yes.
What? It's hard for me to trust that there's like a real evidence-based foundation to understanding what's in these recordings.
Right.
But I also don't know what would like prove to me that it's real.
Well, the proof is if for instance, if we only have a male presence in a room and there's a female response, then how would you explain that?
It's, I don't know, it's interesting. Like, what does this mean to you?
I always was interested in the unknown, and this is bringing some of the unknown into my realm.
Yeah.
Like Chloe telling me yes, that opened my eyes, really, when she told me yes, and I was listening back to it. I'm like, maybe there is something unknown. Not maybe, but she answered me, so there is something there.
So I think it comes down to people's beliefs. And I think that when you finally have something happen to you, I definitely think it changes your mind about things.
I'm back in LA. I've arranged to meet with a guy who takes a more skeptical approach to gods and ghosts.
Chloe up here?
That's him speaking, right? I hear just like a A little bit of a woman's voice.
Michael Shermer is a science historian and founder of the Skeptic Society.
Tell me what you think of the work that paranormal investigators do.
So the ghost hunters, what we call this anomaly hunting. Instead of predicting, this is what we're gonna test, we're gonna look, we're gonna do this. Instead, they just see what happens, and then anything anomalous that stands out, they go, there, that's it. No, sorry, in science, you have to make predictions and then test it, not let's just see what happens and then we'll call whatever weird happens, that's it, that's our thing we're looking for. That's after the fact.
But when it comes to making sense of the world around us, answering big existential questions, even science isn't there yet.
I'd say we've come a long ways in 500 years of science since the scientific revolution, but there's still a lot we don't know. We just use these words like paranormal, supernatural, as kind of linguistic placeholders. Here's this mystery, I'm going to call it that, but that's not an explanation. We still want exactly how does it work.
Believing in the supernatural requires a leap of faith, and an increasing number of Americans are taking that leap thanks to the fallout of 2020.
But it's understandable, you know, with so many people dying above the base rate of, you know, how many people die normally from old age and flus and other diseases, cancer in particular, you know, the number is quite high above that. And that's what I think is pushing people, particularly in families that have been hit by COVID, where they become, at least temporarily, more religious, more spiritual, looking for some kind of stability.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Araceli is back home after visiting the food bank, the NGO that's helping her and her son Gabriel get back on their feet.
And forgive us our trespasses.
Not only has Araceli been out of work, but she got COVID-19 and was seriously ill. At her lowest point, she thought she wouldn't be around to raise her son.
Very good. And who's this here?
The angel Gabriel that told Mary she's going to have Jesus.
Okay, wow, that's very good. Now, why did Mom survive COVID?
Because you believed in God.
Very good. He surprises me every time with the faith, and I think it's because he's has it so deep. 1, 2, 3, 4. This is a very good box. Yes, you know where the rice goes? In the cabinet on the bottom, right?
Blessed, yet broke.
There you go.
It's the little ones that are keeping Araceli going.
A whole gallon of milk. We were really excited about this because there's rarely any milk, so this is really, really wonderful. Oh, perfect, look. It was just perfect enough for the whole fence.
Despite the setbacks, today she's determined to give Gabriel a birthday party to remember.
This year has really brought me closer to God. It's brought me to pray more and not pray alone.
Hi, happy birthday, how many of you?
For the first time, I think I find myself praying with my friends, even though they're different denominations. You know, from Buddhism, Muslim, Christian, you know, we're all together in this.
Thank you.
What's kept me healthy in the way that I've been able to have a better attitude and just be more positive has been just my faith.
After me, should I put up my hair?
Yeah.
Yeah, put up my hair right here, like this.
Did it work?
I feel positive and I feel like, okay, I have hope now. I have hope.
Okay, let's keep going. Let's see if we see many more flowers.
But there's more over there. Look, see all those over there? Look at the rocks. Oh, that's really nice too.